some lack of dental symptoms. There's very few of us psychiatrists in the country who are in population medicine. I am chairman of the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry's Complementary Medicine Committee. Basically, our initiative is to follow what's going on at the National Institute of Mental Health, which is not just giving medications to kids, but finding out what got them. So, for instance, in my office, when you come in, I do genetic testing on everyone. So, there's particularly a gene, it's called MTHFR, and you can tell by getting the genetic report whether you're inactive vitamin D going into the active form. If you can't convert to the active form, you can't even produce enough of the transcripts. So, one of the first things I would do in that patient is give them the active form of vitamin D. The other thing we look at initially is, you know, what is going on with your nutrition. Every patient comes in my office and goes on or is recommended to go on an elimination diet. The reason for that is there are some foods that we're eating that causes the lining of the intestines to get inflamed. And when that does, that allows larger molecules to get into the bloodstream that are not supposed to be there. Because those are seen as foreign, antibodies attack them, and that causes inflammation throughout the body and in the brain. In the brain, what that inflammation does is it prevents tryptophan, which is a protein, from being converted into neurotransmitters like norepinephrine, serotonin, and dopamine. Instead, it's converted into a glutamate agonist, which irritates the brain and makes it sleep. So, one of the first things we do is what do we eat? We also look for like nutritional deficiencies, but this is really what we also do that's very unique. There are a lot of people out there saying they're doing chelation, but they're not board certified. Some of them are not even using equipment that has what we call a scientifically valid database. What I mean by that is, when someone comes in to say, I have a lady who had nerve surgery on the right side of her brain, and basically part of her brain. She had a previous IQ of 140. She came to me on 4 antidepressants. We looked at her nutritionally first, got her shaped up there. And then we put this cap on it, had 19 electrodes on it. And what we did was we were measuring her brain waves. And we then compared that to a normal database. Now that database has to be a scientifically proven, valid database. The problem with a lot of people they're not using scientifically valid databases, so they don't have anything to compare to know what they should do with me. In her case, what we did is we looked at the remaining neurons that were active, and we tried to look at those that were abnormal in that area of the brain that would be more related to aggression than anything else. And we also looked at coherence. We were looking at the connections between the neurons in the brain and trying to improve those. What happened to her is after 22 sessions, she was back to the off for antidepressants. But you've got to know what you're doing. You've got to be board certified. You've got to do a proper amount. There are a lot of people who will just tell you, come in, put a cap on. Wait a minute. If her kid is having, chaotic family life, she's going to be at home. And you haven't asked that question, why are you doing neurofeedback? So you've got to do a proper eval, too, before you even do this, to see what else we may need to do. For instance, maybe they need family therapy. What if a kid has a reading disorder? Nobody's picked it up. I don't want to do neurofeedback first. I want to identify if there's a reading disorder first. So I would do neuropsych testing. So the eval is much more comprehensive than what a lot of people would think when they hear about neurofeedback. A lot of people call my office and say, I want to do neurofeedback, what should I do analysis? And we'll go, we can't do that. We need to evaluate you first and find out what's going on and see if there are other things we need to do, even if it's as simple as nutrition, before we're going to do this. So that's basically what we do. We're actually going before the AMA, my committee and myself, before the American Medical Association this year, to try to get CPT, which is a way for insurance companies to pay for this. We actually have the backing of the Academy of Pediatrics. So I teach it at the medical school. We're one of the only psychiatry departments in the country teaching population.